So, I'm live now. We're here. Leslie McSpaden, talk at ASU. My phone only has 57% power, so I'll probably only be able to do this for about an hour. But yeah, this should be published after the fact. I have some interesting questions, though. I'm not sure we're going to get to them before the phone runs out. It's supposed to go till 9. And it should start soon. It's supposed to have started already, but... yeah.
It's a little bit late.
We've got a wonderful crowd here. All sorts of beautiful people. I still haven't seen Leslie. Maybe this is her, though. I could be completely ignorant. Can I zoom in on this? This is the first time I'm streaming from my phone. Apologize for the coughs. Speaker's coming up. Never mind. And, like everyone suggested last time, I'm filming horizontally now. Make everyone's life 1,000% better. This must be Leslie. The event's about to start. Life is real.
Citizens Guide to Criminal Justice, a three-day-long clinic. These 3 days have been dedicated to educating the ASU community on the status of our criminal justice system through panels, movie screenings, and special guest speakers like tonight. This event and this clinic were built with you all in mind, so thank each one of you for being here tonight. I would also like to give a special thanks to the Black African Coalition and the ASU chapter of the NAACP for collaborating with the Women's Coalition to help make tonight possible. I am so pleased to be able to introduce tonight's moderator, Dr. Ursula Orr from the ASU School of Social Transformation. Dr. Orr is an author of several publications, an educator, and an empowered Black woman. She will be helping to lead tonight's conversation around identity, justice, and democracy in America with our special guest speaker, Ms. Leslie McSpaden. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ursula Orr. Please, everyone, welcome to the stage, Ms. Leslie McSpaden.
Take that, 90 champion. No. Ooh. Yeah. Blessed. Yeah.
Thank you.
Woo.
Thanks for having me. I'm going to try this again. Good evening. How are you all today?
Blessed.
My name is Dr. Ursula Orr. I'm the Lincoln Professor of Ethics in the School of Social Transformation and Assistant Professor of African Ethnic Studies here at ASU. The magnificent Mrs. Leslie McSpadden. And for tonight's lecture, The Purpose of Democracy and Identity, a Q&A with Black Lives Matter activist, author, and mother of Michael Brown, Mrs. Leslie McSpadden. Again, thank you so much for joining us this evening. I'll be transparent and say that I have a hard time figuring out exactly where to start. This is a conversation that's incredibly pertinent, not just for all of us, but immediately personally for me. Ms. McSpadden models a number of things that I myself have been struggling with, how to manage, how to walk in certain difficult moments, how to maintain faith, how to make sense out of what makes little. And tonight we're here together to hear some insights, advice, direction, to develop a better understanding of how we might be able to combat anti-Black sentiment, anti-Black police brutality, and ultimately how to critique this, how to speak back to this, and how to make those of us who this might not seem to be a pertinent issue or situation, or an immediately affecting or impacting situation, one they recognize that not just only impacts people who walk in bodies that look like mine and Mrs. McSpadden's, but that it affects all of us. Just because certain bodies may not be the immediate body of the mind doesn't mean that we're not all affected. Mrs. McSpadden, would you mind letting us know a little bit about who you are?
I'm not just the mother of Michael Brown. I have three other children. My daughter, her name is Deja Brown. That is Michael's sibling. They both share me as a mother and the same father. She is a freshman at TSU in Nashville. She has used this situation to not only become now the leader of that, because my son is gone, but to propel her in a way where she gets to speak out about her brother and she can say his name and not call him first and like everyone else tries to. I have a 13-year-old son. His name's Andre. He's great. He's been on honor roll since third grade. He made it to Captain Safe Patrol. Now he's a part of a boys group called, which has escaped my mind, but as much as she can understand at her young age. I am married to a wonderful man who has been loyal to me throughout it all. I try to push him away, ask him to leave because I don't feel I am a very outspoken, hardworking, faithful, trustworthy, understanding woman. And I've come a long way. And in a short time of missing my son, I feel like I went even longer. Every day I get up and I express this to you all. And you know what? They're really quiet when no one is there. But I come from to do a rally or to raise awareness about what is going on for even if they seem to care. But when all those people are away, including the lights and the cameras, it doesn't seem like anyone cares anymore. So I did decide that I wanted to run for city council. But as I stated, hold up, man.
We still need to get hurt.
Yeah, we still need
to. Hold on to it, though.
But I was pushed up against the wall because I would have had to become a Ferguson resident. And I'm going to be honest with you, like, pride at the moment just would not let me give more to Ferguson in that moment. And but it's a big but because I want to be the face of change. I want to be that person who steps into the city council who has been directly affected to show them what change is and how to make it better for our minorities in the community of Ferguson. Ferguson is not what people think it is. I've experienced a lot of people come from other places, they come into Ferguson and I watch it on the TV screen and their minds have totally changed about what they saw and what they think their neighborhood is and what their neighborhood really looks like to the naked eye and how there's a complete separation of where the blacks live and where the whites live. And in a black area, there are no pretty houses or green grass or nice shiny cars. It's abandoned buildings, they're dirt roads, they're stores on every corner that are selling everything but the right thing. This is what's in that neighborhood. So when you're surrounded by something that's all you know, what else do you do? So being that voice and being that face is very impressive. It's very important. We need more people to do the same thing. To speak out right where you are right now about what you see happening and not what happened years and years ago, because those people they seem to not understand, but they're watching the same thing that we're watching. And I think more of us have to be in office to be elected and run for these seats and become police officers.
Y'all hear this?
To show them how to not only communicate with us, but how to get along with us, and that we're not always the problem. Sometimes that other person could be the agitator and the problem, and when you're given the authority to shoot and kill with no response, no remorse, no responsibility, it lingers and it goes on and on and on, and we just start having to be in separate.
For those of you who don't know, this is
Spanish
Ferguson. Stephen Clark, 22-year-old father of two, who was shot, riddled with 20 bullets by two officers as he stood in the backyard of his grandparents' home on the phone with the mother of his children. What would you
in those moments, what has been your support? What has helped lift you up? What has helped you stand?
Okay, I can tell you two businesses, and it's one has to do with my son. Every night I would go in my room and I would lay in the dark, no lights, no sound, nothing. And I would just have the fan going, 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 and I would lay there with my eyes open, looking for something in the dark. And I did that for about a week. And I cried, and I cried, and I cried. And I just asked the Lord to give me some type of sign to let me know that my son had made it into heaven. And I know most people don't believe in things like that, but several nights later, I did the same thing, and I could see my son so vividly come to me in his black jacket that I like to see him wear. And he said, "Mama, I'm all right." He told me, he said, "Mama, I'm all right." And I tried to wake my husband, but it's like nobody else could see or hear this but me. And that's when I felt paralyzed because I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And I was not going to get out that bed the next day until, and this is the second person, my baby girl, Jazzy, she came to the door fully dressed in her uniform. And she said, "Mom, I want to go." And picks them up. I make sure that I'm up to greet her, to let her know that I'm still your mom. And I'm still here for you. And I'm going to continue to go strong for you. And they saw that. I had to pull it together. And that's what did it for me when she came to that door in that uniform at 7 years old.
When you speak on the side of how my kid is after that, he was the eldest, he got the mom, he got the brain, he got the school. Likewise, seen God, and he likewise spoke to the family about what he was facing, and trying to explain to God and make sense of it, but nobody else could see it. Nobody.
Thank you. Hello? Technology is not always our friend. Thank you for bearing with us. I was thinking about how Mike, in his final days, had recognized that God had spoken to him, and he was working to communicate that message to his family. What do you feel as though he recognized? What do you feel as though he saw? Because his last posts seem to really identify a young man who was reading the world in a particular way and unafraid about communicating, articulating to a larger public what it was that he saw. And the fact that you didn't see these posts for months after the fact, I was curious to know what that might have done for you, for your son, for you to recognize and understand that your son had this understanding, that he had this vision, that he was having this ongoing conversation.
What a lot of people don't know is that Mike McCombs was raised in a church from the womb to the very end. Church in her living room every Saturday, and whether he wanted to be a part of it or not, he was a part of it. And to me, I can see those posts because my kids have me blocked, because I'd be on there like, what is this? So for me, that proved to me that he was really listening, he was really paying attention, he was enthused, and he knew what was going on. He felt it, but he couldn't express it to us at that time. So for him to become whole, just like the rainbow, he let his grandmother and I know that our efforts weren't in vain when it came to trying to get him into church and stay in the church. It's like, I want to be here, I'm leaving, but he was still there in another room listening. But you know, that's how kids do when it comes to church. They just don't want to sit there and listen. They like, oh, is it over yet? You know. But that's what that said to me. You know, sometimes you can talk to a person, you feel like they're not listening, or they don't hear you, but he did. And he just spoke to us, but in a different way. He didn't get it from the mouth, but from the heart. He put on paper.
I keep mentioning and referring back to your memoir, Tell the Truth and Shame the Devil, The Life, Legacy, and Love of My Son, Michael Brown. What was the significance of this book for the readers, and more importantly, how was it significant for you?
For the readers, it was important and significant because they only got a 18-second glimpse into who the media tried to portray my son to be. And I wanted to share the last 18 years of his life with you all from his mother, who knows him best, better than anybody else. And with telling this story, I had to go into detail about myself, because I did have Michael at 16 years old. I did sacrifice some things. I did, I had to grow up and mature and raise my son. I took you through that journey and to show you the perseverance of a woman, a black woman.
And we thank you for that. Thank you. We need models. We need. As we spoke earlier today, to testify to what it is they witness, to the way that America works against them strategically, purposefully, historically, consistently, consistently. With that said, what is democracy to you? Do you see your memoir as a way in which we might be able to begin asking certain questions, perhaps the right kinds of questions, that might lead us to a more democratic, a more just, more equitable society? A society in which we might actually be able to not simply hear one another, but see the humanity that resides in each other despite the fact that our bodies might look differently?
You know, August 9th, 2014, the 10th, the 11th, and the days after, those were the chants. This is what democracy looks like. And just like we see in this audience right now, lots of different shades. It was pulling the Band-Aid off a wound for a lot of families, a lot of mothers and fathers who had been through the same thing, and no one threw them a buoy. No one said, let's save them, let's help them. I think we were somewhat, what you want to call fortunate, when it happened in life, because someone somewhere was looking and paying attention. But the justice didn't come, and it hasn't come. And I can't tell you what justice looks like, because I've never seen it.
How are justice and democracy seen differently or manifest differently in the lives of Black people? When you say you haven't seen it, can you give us two examples of what it doesn't look like? What it does not look like?
Justice doesn't look like my son laying face down with a sheet over him and a shoe 15 feet away and a hat 20 feet away and a person admitting to what they did and how they did it and not being held accountable. And with the DOJ telling me that they will not indict because they don't want to carry the burden. With the DOJ having me to wait more than 100 days for no justice, call me to an office and make me wait an hour and 45 minutes, invite me in a room with a stack of papers that they don't even go through, but they tell me that they're not going to indict. Significant reason. I can go on and on about what it doesn't look like.
In Black homes across the country, parents have a conversation. And it's not an easy conversation. But it's a conversation that we have to have because, frankly put, that being the reality, whether you choose to accept it or not, whether it seems to be your reality or not, is the truth. What kind of talks did you have with your son? What kind of talks do you have with your children? What kind of talks should we be having with our kids? What are the things that we should be saying that we might avoid to say? Whether we are Black parents, white parents, Asian parents, whatever kind of parents we are, what kind of conversations around racism, anti-black police brutality, anti-black sentiment do we need to be having with our children?
Interesting because I didn't have a police talk with my son. I didn't know that there was a conversation out here that you're supposed to have with your son because he's black about the police. As a woman and as a mother raising sons, the only talk I thought I was supposed to have was put that thing on. Serious. That's the only conversation I was aware of. This is new to me. And I've been to several panels and conferences where there are pamphlets that they now hand out, and it tells you these different steps to take as a black man and as a black boy when you have an encounter with an officer of any color. And it goes up to 10 steps. So what happens when you do all 10 and you still don't make it? But I'm not a believer in that conversation. I don't feel that that conversation is for parents to have with children. That conversation should be part of the training for an officer. No social training, there's no skills, you know, and these people are coming into our neighborhoods and they're not familiar. They don't know that Uncle Cleo may walk to the store all day back and forth because he doesn't drive. And he can barely see. He got on the boot, I mean, Richard, what's that called? SSI. So he can do that. He did his stuff. He did what he was supposed to do in life. He enjoying that bird. Every 5 minutes he goes back and forth. You know, I'm saying to say that those things happen in neighborhoods and you could become familiar with people. We had to become familiar with officer friendly when we were being raised at on our grandmother's street. Every year we go out to pop flowers, we know we're not supposed to pop them. And here he come. So we gonna hide him, he gonna pull up and say something to us. He might take him, but there's a rapport. And he knows that every 4th of July, make sure you and the grandkids gonna be out here popping them fireworks. But there's no rapport in Ferguson. No one knew anybody. Those officers today still don't see them pull over and get out the car and have a conversation. So what we saw happen in 2014 at Ferguson has not changed Ferguson.
What can we do to change society's views about the police? And we have a litany of names, of individuals, of men, women, children, boys, and girls, who have all unarmed died at the hands of police. We've seen how the police and law enforcement writ large is not held accountable. We listen to the discourse of, quote, I fear for my life, and the question for me becomes, who has the true right to fear for their life? How is it that an officer's right to life, right, is greater than my own? And then when you have, you know, the ongoing conversation of, well, this person was in the wrong, right? And this officer's in the right. And much of that rightness with regards to the officer has to do with the fact that they are literally clothed in blue. And this uniform is a code for rightness, right, and justice. It is a code, a sign that says, I'm not questioned because I'm always in the right. And if you see someone on the opposite end of my hand, of my body, of my gun, then they must have done something wrong, because the only time when an officer snatches you up is if you did something wrong. How do we make it clear that it's not that simple? That it's not, pun intended, problematically so, that black and white?
When I did the Dr. I show, some of the mothers on that panel were, their children were the Dallas police. They had been gunned down when all of that happened. And, I couldn't express to her enough that I could understand her pain of losing her son, although he wore that uniform. Because people were starting to not look at the person, and they're looking at the uniform. But everybody is important to somebody. Everybody means the world to somebody. And I saw her hurt just like I hurt for the loss of her son, only because her son was in a uniform. But I had to try to make her understand that my son was only in flip-flops, black skin with a red hat. And just as well as your son was judged because of his uniform, his clothing, this is what happens in our communities every day. And no, it's not okay. And I'm not against you because your son chose that job or because your son is of a different race. I'm not. Completely understand. And we sat there together and held hands and cried, and me and that woman shared something. We both had to bury our son. He's still on my wife. It's real good. And I don't know where it would end, and I don't know where it started. We're in the middle, and we have to learn how to come together and love life. Life. Love life. Everyone isn't kind. And we see a lot of crazies out here too, but you know, if we show more of the good things, I think it would be better. We see so much bad being highlighted. Why is that? Don't say because of 45. Okay.
It's still just waiting for 45. It ain't nothing new, it's just the iteration of the old saying. You know what I'm saying? The more things change, y'all know the adage. The more things change, you know what I'm saying? Some of y'all been to church now. Talk about that call response. I am aware of our time, and I just want to make sure that I'm staying on task. Leslie, is there anything that you want to let us know? Something that you need for us to walk away with tonight? Whether it is about Michael, whether it is about your family, what it means to be a part of a village and to have that kind of support. What do you want to leave us with tonight? What do we need to know in order to, I would think, how to pay attention and understand this reoccurring issue, how to address it effectively, what our individual roles might be, whether that just simply means showing up, participating in the conversation, coming to the table, letting your faith be stronger than your fear, which is what my mama always told me. Ain't that right, bro? What would you, because But many of the people, students, right, some were on purpose.
No, Doc, it was really hard for me in the beginning to even get off the couch. And everyone would just ask me, what do you want to do? What do you want to do? This makes you want to get physical, but it's not a physical fight. It is a very mental fight. And we could start by putting ourselves in those positions to make those ultimate decisions that are made for us. Something that we've never had the opportunity to do. And just know that with one person, you can be a movement. All within yourself. You don't need a whole hype and a whole crowd, but if you start right there and be that voice for what you see is not right and never been right and you want to make it right, say something. And the way the world is set up now with all the social media, someone is listening and someone is watching, definitely. Even when you think they're not. I appreciate everybody in this room tonight. And I just want you to know that this is not something that I would ever want anybody to do by themselves or publicly, because it's hard and it's not a good feeling. And you never find the time more, and you will never feel like yourself again. I'll never be whole again. But I'll save my wins and my lies for my time when I meet my man.
Now, are we taking questions from you?